Hello everyone, in today's video I'm gonna talk about hybridization techniques, or we can also call them as blotting techniques. Under this topic I'm gonna discuss about southern blotting, northern blotting and western blotting. In this video I'm gonna specifically talk about southern blotting, and you can find northern blotting in part 2 of this video, and in part 3 of this video you can check out for the western blotting technique. In this southern blotting technique, we are going to identify DNA. Whereas in case of northern blotting, we are going to identify the presence of specific RNA sequence. Whereas coming to the western blotting, here we are going to identify a specific protein from a mixture of proteins. Mostly the southern and northern blotting are quite similar, only the difference is like we are going to identify the presence of specific DNA sequence with the help of southern blotting technique, and we are going to identify the presence of RNA sequence in case of northern blotting technique. Here in northern blotting technique we can easily study the gene expression by finding the presence of RNA with the help of a probe. In western blotting technique, if we have a mixture of proteins and our target is to identify a specific protein, we can go with this technique where we are going to identify that protein with the help of specific antibodies, right? And we are saying that these are the blotting techniques because once we separate these molecules, either it could be DNA, RNA or a protein, after we separate these compounds with the help of electrophoretic techniques, we are going to transfer the DNA or RNA or a protein onto a membrane that resembles a blot. So we simply call these techniques as blotting techniques, and we are calling them as hybridization techniques. Why? Because in case of southern blotting and northern blotting, we are going to use some probes with a known sequence. And these probes will go and hybridize with the DNA or RNA in case of northern blotting if both of them are complementary to each other. So that we call it as hybridization. But when we come to western blotting technique, we are using a specific antibodies. We here use a primary antibodies which are specific to the protein, and then followed by the addition of secondary antibodies conjugated with radioactive isotopes or an enzyme which will react with a substrate giving rise to a colored product. In this way we are going to find out the presence of a specific protein. Only this antibody will go and bind with the specific protein, and that helps us to find out, or that helps us to detect the presence of a specific protein. And this is how, with the help of these blotting techniques, it is possible to identify the presence of the nucleic acids, DNA or RNA, and also helps us to identify the presence of specific protein. Whatever the blotting technique is, whether it could be a southern blotting, northern blotting or a western blotting, there are basic steps that are to be followed. Those are, the first important step is homogenizing the sample. Like I already told you how to isolate the nucleic acids. Whatever the source you choose, whether it could be a bacterial cell, plant cell or an animal cell, the first step is you need to homogenize the sample. That is in process of extraction and the isolation of a molecule, right? And followed by the separation of molecule of interest by electrophoresis. You can go with the any of the electrophoretic techniques. So please watch my videos on electrophoretic techniques. If you want to separate a protein molecule, you can go with the SDS page. Or if you want to separate the nucleic acids, either DNA or RNA, you can go with the agarose gel electrophoretic techniques. So here what we are going to do in the first step, that is once you homogenize the sample, once you isolate the proteins or the nucleic acids, what you are going to do in the next step, you are going to separate those molecules based on the size and charge using the electrophoretic techniques. You all know what happens in electrophoresis technique. When you apply an electric field, that is, here we are going to separate the molecules based on the size and the charge under the influence of an applied electric field, right? So here there will be a negative charge and here there will be a positive charge. That is, from cathode to anode, these molecules will migrate towards the opposite charge. The proteins and the nucleic acids which carry the negative charge will move towards the opposite charge, that is towards the anode, right? And here we are going to achieve the separation based on the size. Each protein or each DNA molecule will have a different molecular weight and different size, right? So once you apply the electric field, so the different DNA fragments will migrate through the pores of a gel and they will move to the opposite side, and the smaller fragments will move faster compared to the larger fragments. That is the reason they will be seen at the end of the gel far away from the well, whereas the larger fragments will be seen near to the well because their migration will be slow compared to the smaller fragments. And here, based on the size, we are going to separate the DNA or a protein. And for the nucleic acids, we carry out agarose gel electrophoresis. And for the proteins, we go with the SDS page. Of course, for nucleic acids, you can also use polyacrylamide gels, right? Once you finish with the step of electrophoresis, then what you are going to do? Here you are going to transfer those molecules onto a nitrocellulose membrane, or you can also use a nylon membrane. That is nothing but your blotting. First, suppose you got a gel with a 5 DNA bands. And now you are going to transfer this DNA onto a nitrocellulose membrane. And when you carry out this transfer procedure, you are again going to get these 5 bands that got transferred onto this nitrocellulose membrane. This is nothing but a blotting. So that is the reason we are giving the name of these techniques as blotting techniques, right? For example, if you have a original document of your mark sheet and in process of applying for a job, you are supposed to submit the Xerox copies, right? So if you observe the Xerox copy, it will be like a replica of your original document, right? So whatever the information that is present in the original document can be seen in this Xerox copy as well, right? So it's like a replica. Here also, what we are going to do is we are going to transfer this DNA bands onto a membrane, which will be a replica of this gel. So the entire banding pattern can be seen on this membrane also, that is present on the gel that we got after we run the electrophoretic techniques, right? So that resembles the blotting. So we are going to transfer that particular molecule, whether it could be DNA, RNA or a protein, from the gel to the nitrocellulose membrane or a nylon membrane. So this is nothing but we call it as a blotting procedure. Next comes is the hybridization, where we are going to use probes in process of identifying the DNA or RNA, and we are going to use specific antibodies for the detection of a protein. And we are going to hybridize that particular molecule with the probes or with the antibodies, followed by the identification of a molecule, whether it could be DNA, RNA or a protein. This is how we perform this blotting technique in this series of steps. Now let's discuss in detail about the Southern blotting technique in this video. Coming to the technique of Southern blotting, this technique was developed by Edwin M. Southern in the year 1975. So after the discovery of this technique by Southern, this technique was so called as Southern blotting technique. And here we are going to transfer the DNA from the gel to the nitrocellulose membrane, that resembles the blotting. So we call it as a blotting technique. As this technique was developed by Edwin M. Southern, this technique was called as Southern blotting technique. And the other name for this blotting technique is DNA-DNA hybridization technique, right? We are calling it as DNA-DNA hybridization technique. So in this technique, we are going to identify the specific DNA molecule. So for this purpose, what we are supposed to do is, first we need to isolate the nucleic acid, that is DNA. DNA stands for deoxyribonucleic acid. So here in this technique, the first step is to isolate the DNA from the cells or from a tissue. Okay, I am going to provide you I-code. Please go through my video on isolation of nucleic acids. Like, you can choose any of the source, whether it could be a plant source or a bacterial cell. First thing is, you need to break the cell. Once you break the cell, all the cytoplasmic contents will be released out. That may contain a protein, RNA and DNA. But here for this technique, we are interested in isolation of DNA only. Right? So using some detergents, you are going to break the cell wall and the cell membrane, and then you are going to use an enzyme proteinase to denature the protein and RNAs to denature the presence of RNA. And now you are going to isolate the pure form of DNA. Once you isolate the DNA, you are going to separate the DNA fragments based on the size using a agarose gel electrophoresis technique. Okay. Once you are done with the isolation of the DNA, then what you are supposed to do? You have to perform agarose gel electrophoresis technique, where you are going to separate the DNA molecules based on the size, right? After you separate the DNA based on the size using the agarose gel electrophoresis technique, what you are supposed to do? You have to carry out the blotting procedure. This DNA fragments which are present on the gel will be transferred onto a nitrocellulose membrane. So this is a replica of this gel. Whatever the banding pattern that you see on the gel will be transferred onto a nitrocellulose membrane. Right, exactly same to same, at the same position you can see the DNA bands on this nitrocellulose membrane. Then after the blotting procedure, you have to go with the hybridization step. So in this hybridization step, you're going to use a radio-labeled probes. And these probes are synthesized chemically with a known sequence. Right? For example, here we have some 6 to 7 DNA bands. And the sequence is like ATGC, CATG, GATC, CCTA, ATGA, GATA. So this is the sequence of the DNA fragments. And all these fragments will have a different molecular weight. Based on the size, we have separated the DNA and we got the different DNA fragments that are separated with the help of electrophoresis. After electrophoresis, what you have done? You are going to transfer this DNA bands onto a nitrocellulose membrane, followed by the hybridization step. In process of this hybridization, we are going to add a solution containing a radio labeled probes. And for suppose if this probe have a sequence of TACT. So this is the known sequence of a probe. And when you apply these probes will go and hybridize with the DNA sequence if they both are complementary to each other. So if you observe the sequence here, this probe will go and bind over here. Because thymine pairs with adenine, adenine pairs with thymine, guanine pairs with cytosine, and thymine pairs with adenine. So there will be a formation of hydrogen bonds in between these two fragments. One is a probe and the other one is the DNA fragment. As this DNA and probe both are complementary to each other, they will hybridize. Right? So after this step of hybridization, what we are going to do? We are going to detect the presence of the particular DNA fragment. Here the probe is carrying a radio labeled isotope. So when you subject this membrane to autoradiography, we can easily visualize this particular hybridized band. So only one band got hybridized with the probe, right? So you'll have an X-ray film where you can identify a single band. So you can easily make out that this particular band is of our interest, which is complementary with the probe that we have designed ourselves with the known sequence. In this way, we are going to find out the presence of a particular DNA sequence with the help of this southern blotting technique. I will explain you each step in detail with the help of a diagram. As I told you earlier, with the help of this southern blotting technique, we are going to identify the gene of interest. So initially, what we have to do is we need to isolate the genomic DNA, right? You can use any source, like you can use cells or tissues for the isolation of genomic DNA, right? Once you are done isolating the genomic DNA, you have to use restriction enzymes for digesting this genomic DNA. So after you digest this genomic DNA with the help of restriction enzymes, you are going to get the multiple DNA fragments. I hope you all know the role of restriction enzymes. These restriction enzymes will cleave DNA at a specific site, right? For example, this is a DNA fragment. And when you treat this DNA with the restriction enzymes, these enzymes will cut DNA at a specific site where you can get two DNA bands. That depends on the presence of these restriction sites. It may cleave at two or three positions, or it may cleave exactly at a single position. That depends on the presence of the sequence in the DNA. For example, if you take a restriction enzyme called EcoR1, okay, this enzyme will recognize the sequence of GAATTC. Okay, if this sequence is present in the DNA, when you treat that DNA with this EcoR1 enzyme, so this is a enzyme that was isolated from E. coli, and it will recognize the sequence of GAATTC, and it will specifically cut in between this guanine and adenine. Right? If this DNA have this GAATTC sequence, and if you use the restriction enzyme EcoR1, it will specifically cut in between this guanine and adenine. Right? In this way, like there are many number of restriction enzymes, each restriction enzyme will have a specific sequence. That means they will recognize that particular sequence in the DNA, and they will exactly cut the DNA at that particular position. Right? So here in this first step, after you isolate the genomic DNA, you are going to digest the DNA with the help of restriction enzymes, and you are going to get a multiple DNA fragments, each with a different size, and each DNA fragment will have a different molecular weight, right? So based on that difference, we are going to separate the DNA fragments using the agarose gel electrophoresis technique. I already told you how to perform this agarose gel electrophoresis technique. See, once you apply an electric field, all the DNA fragments which carries the negative charge, see here there will be a well, and you are going to load DNA sample here. And under the influence of the applied electric charge, all the DNA fragments which carries a uniform negative charge will move towards the opposite charge. That is, they move from the cathode to the anode. Because though all the DNA fragments carry the same charge, but they are different in size. And that is the reason this fragment will be smaller compared to this fragment. And this smaller fragment will move fastly compared to the larger fragment. And that is the reason you can see at the end of the gel, which is away from the well. Whereas this fragment will migrate slowly compared to this smaller fragment, because it is larger in size compared to this DNA fragment. And that is the reason it will be seen at the top of the gel, that is near the well. In this way, based on the size, we are going to separate the DNA fragments. Now you got a different DNA bands over the gel. Now, after the technique of electrophoresis, you have separated the DNA based on the size. So you can see the pattern of DNA bands on a gel. Now, in the next step, you have to denature with alkali. You are going to use NaOH solution, that is sodium hydroxide solution. So when you use this alkali solution, This NaOH will cause denaturation. That is, the double stranded DNA will be converted into a single stranded. That is nothing but we call it as a denaturation. Right? After the step of denaturation, here comes the blotting. Right? What we are going to do here? We are going to transfer the DNA bands which are present on the gel onto a nitrocellulose membrane or onto a nylon membrane. You may get a doubt that why can't we proceed directly with the gel instead of transferring it onto a membrane. See, gel is very fragile and it can be easily broken. We can't carry out further studies with the help of this gel. But here the membrane is stable compared to the gel. And when we bake this membrane at 80 degrees centigrade, we can constantly fix the DNA bands onto the membrane. But that is not possible in case of the gel. Why? Because if you heat the gel, what happens? It will be liquefied, right? So to avoid that problem, and since the gels are fragile, we are going to transfer those DNA bands from the gel to the nitrocellulose membrane, right? After you transfer the DNA bands from the gel to the membrane, then you are going to hybridize with the help of a probes. See here, if you observe this picture carefully, this is a transfer buffer. And at the bottom, you are going to place some filter papers. Those are buffer saturated filter papers. And on the top of those buffer saturated filter papers, you are going to place the gel. And this gel contains the separated DNA bands. Okay, and on the top of the gel, you are going to place the nitrocellulose membrane or nylon membrane. So this red color indicates the presence of the membrane on top of the gel, right? And on top of the nitrocellulose membrane, you are going to place some dry filter papers. At bottom, you are going to place buffer saturated filter papers. And on the top of the nitrocellulose membrane, you are going to place some dry filter papers. And on the top, you have to place some weight. It's nothing but like a sandwich preparation, right? You are going to place the gel, and on the top of the gel, you are going to place the nitrocellulose membrane, because you are going to transfer the DNA bands that are present on the gel onto the nitrocellulose membrane. So what all the information that is present on the gel will be transferred onto the nitrocellulose membrane. So here at the bottom, you are going to place a buffer saturated filter papers, but on the top, the filter papers are dry. So once when the buffer passes through the gel by the capillary action, so the DNA bands which are present on the agarose gel will be transferred onto a nitrocellulose membrane. So this dry filter papers will absorb the buffer. In this tank, we are going to pour a transfer buffer, and the filter papers were dipped in that buffer. The filter papers which we keep at the bottom of the gel, and on the top of the gel, we are going to place the nitrocellulose membrane, and our intention is to transfer the DNA bands from the gel to the membrane, right? And on the top of the nitrocellulose membrane, we are placing some dry filter papers, and these filter papers will absorb the buffer, right, by the capillary action. And this buffer will pass through the gel and onto the nitrocellulose membrane. So what all the DNA bands that are present on the agarose gel will be transferred onto the nitrocellulose membrane. That we call it as blotting. Hope you are clear. For suppose after electrophoresis, we got 4 DNA bands, right? And this gel is carrying 4 DNA bands. After the blotting, so these DNA bands will be transferred onto the membrane exactly at the same position. And now the membrane will also have those 4 DNA bands. So this nitrocellulose membrane is the replica of a gel. Okay. And now after you transfer the DNA bands onto the nitrocellulose membrane, what you are supposed to do, you have to add a solution that contains radio labeled probes. Okay, so these probes will go and hybridize with the DNA if they both are complementary to each other. So here, if you observe this picture where you can see only the two bands, that means here these probes are complementary with these two DNA bands. And now, how will you detect that specific DNA bands after the hybridization with the probes? You have to subject it to autoradiography. So when you observe this X-ray film, you can easily make out the presence of those DNA bands. Because here we are using a radio labeled probes, right? So once these probes go and hybridize with the DNA, see, out of four DNA bands, it got hybridized with the first band and the last band, because both these are complementary with the probe, right? The sequence information which is present in the probe is already known, so we can easily make out the information that is present in the DNA. If the probe carries a sequence of GAATC, so what will be the sequence in the DNA? The sequence will be CTTAG. So we can easily make out, because we already know the sequence of a probe, and when it go and hybridize with the DNA, we can easily make out the sequence that is present in the DNA. So here, if you observe this picture, when you subject it to autoradiography and when you observe this X-ray film, you can easily make out the bands that got hybridized with the probe. So these are the DNA of our interest. Or simply, you can say that these are the genes of our interest. In this way, we can easily detect the presence of particular genes with the help of the Southern blotting technique. And moreover, with the help of these techniques, we can also determine the molecular weight of that particular DNA band. Because when you perform the electrophoretic technique, you can also run the molecular marker in parallel with the samples. So by comparing the band with the ladder, you can easily determine the molecular weight of that particular DNA fragment. This is all about the Southern blotting technique. And in continuity with this topic, I'm going to talk about the Northern blotting technique in the part 2 of this video. Thank you.